Do you know if he's intoxicated or not?
Highly.
Temper.
Not causing problems, though?
No, he's not, but he is intoxicated.
I was used to holding the powerful accountable, asking tough questions, and that I made a career out of.
Hey, Randy, did you want to clarify any of the comments in the paper from last night at all?
Getting ready to practice, all right?
Could we talk to you afterwards about that, the comments in the paper?
How do you defend to the critics that Fox News is far from being fair and balanced, especially when you got a lineup of Sarah Palin, Glenn Beck, Hannity? We know that was just in the news.
Sarah Palin is a contributor to Fox News. Geraldine Ferraro has been a contributor to Fox News for over 10 years.
He's going open spirit kind of guy.
In his only televised interview, Tyson talked about what the rape allegations and the emotional toll the investigation has taken on him.
You see the finished product. You really get excited about this for release in August?
Well, I am excited about it for moviegoers.
I certainly knew that, you know, at the end when I couldn't walk 100 feet back to my condo, my apartment, without creating a problem, resigning from my job, losing everything, I had a huge problem. But I think it was probably 10 years earlier. You know, as I was getting divorced, I just didn't want to feel the pain. And I didn't know how to deal with those issues. And so what I did is I drank.
His ex-wife, the prominent anchor on Headline News, Christi Paul, has written a book.
So when he came home and he'd been drinking and, you know, threw his ring at me. I don't ever want to see you again unless it's in divorce court.
But I can't understand why somebody didn't. I'm angry with the doctors that were dealing with you guys that nobody treated his alcoholism. Well, that poor guy never got treatment for his alcoholism. This is all alcoholism. He was abusive when he was drinking.
Yes.
He was a different person when he drank. This is classic alcoholism and classic codependency, you'll permit me.
Absolutely.
And,
I own that,
and
yeah.
And no Al-Anon, no AA, nothing gets better.
You know, I hope that people watching this documentary are encouraged to come forward and tell their stories. I hope that maybe, you know, this is a path that'll lead me to tell other people's stories and that we can spread it all out on the internet and you can understand what alcoholism and addiction is. It's nothing to be ashamed of. You know, we are some of the strongest people out there. Let's show them. Let's explain what we've gone through and then show them what we've accomplished now.
Hi, welcome. This is Shira Goldberg, and you are watching The Addiction Show. Today I have with me someone who's so interesting. He just cracks me up. He had quite a little adventure back in the day, which he'll tell us about. His name is Rob Koebel. He used to be a Milwaukee news reporter. He'll tell us what station, maybe, perhaps. So welcome, Rob. Thanks for joining us today.
Hey, Shira. Thanks for having me. Really appreciate it.
Now, you have really turned it around, which is always great to see because you're going to inspire countless individuals to do the same and follow suit. So why don't you just tell us a little bit about who you are and what your story is?
Sure. Well, for about 18, 19 years, I was an investigative reporter, and I've traveled the country, worked for all different affiliates and all different companies, and, you know, really enjoyed, loved the job. The job was to hold the powerful accountable, you know, as have you seen, and, you know, really, I won my Emmy Awards, I won my Murrow Awards, and really got to do a lot of fun things. Throughout that entire time, you know, I struggled with addiction, and it was specifically alcohol. So what people saw on the camera wasn't necessarily what was happening behind the camera, and that was a long battle with booze, basically a binge drinker. I worked hard and I partied hard, and that's sort of the way that I learned to relieve the stress and anxiety, you know, that a job like that or many jobs, you know, we all face and do. For me, it wasn't working out, it wasn't running or doing any of that kind of stuff. It was hitting that bottle, and it was you know, a bad choice to do that.
Yeah, it was a bad choice.
Yeah, learn it the hard way, but don't we all?
Is there an easy way to learn that?
I wish there was, and I wish I was a lot younger when I did learn it. But hey, you know, I've got 2 years as of last week, and I never thought that's the longest of my lifetime.
That's really incredible. I really like hearing from people that have younger sobriety because it seems more attainable for people that are considering this life and this lifestyle. So I think it resonates more. What do you think about that?
No, I think you're right. I think that, you know, we all hear, you know, I want to have that 18, 20 years and everything, but, you know, day by day it's a struggle as you do this. And I, you know, that I've learned in the last 2 years is that real work begins when you put the bottle aside. And, you know, I did go to rehab. I spent 90 days at a place in Greensboro, North Carolina. So yeah, I did the 28 days, and then I went to an extended treatment to work on the issues of why I drank. And that began to explain to me, you know, really what alcoholism is and the disease. And I think it is great, you know, that we see some of the younger people that, you know, are just struggling with it. But, you know, remembering the fact that it's a lot of hard work. But what isn't hard work if it's something so great that you really want? And, you know, my family reminds me of that. My friends, you know, a lot of people remind me of that. Nothing's easy, but if you really want it, then you got to work for it.
Yeah, absolutely. I do interact with people that would really love to be sober if it was like just a magic formula, if they could just drink some magic potion.
I tried naltrexone for a while. I mean, that stopped one of the first things I did. You know, that stopped the cravings. But then what I didn't listen to them is the fact is, yeah, we can stop you doing that, but here's the other problem. You've got to deal with why you've been drinking. And that's what I found the most important part is, you know, we've got to clean up that mess. We've got to take accountability for, you know, some of those things that we did in active addiction and said. And that's the hardest part. And I understand that now. And now I have to live life, you know, on life's terms sober. And it's difficult. And it's a different feeling. But I have the tools to be able to do that now.
I'm glad you brought that up. Someone I know just wrote an article for The Fix, and it's very controversial, but he's very controversial. And there's always a debate about whether you should try therapy, you should try spirituality, you should try AA, you should try medical-assisted treatment. It's like, I mean, what doesn't it make sense to just figure out what works best for you?
It does, and I think I support the same thing. Now, I think everybody has to look. I think there's basic, you know, understandings that we're going to hit in all those different programs, and I think that's taking accountability and dealing with your past, coming to accept who we are now, understanding that, you know, even without the booze or the drugs, there's still, you know, some character defects. But I agree with you. Why are we going to shove one way down people's throats when all we want to do is help them so that they can walk with us and take that journey too away from that? So I agree with you, and I think, you know, it's a huge point of contention for a lot of people in recovery. And to me, I think that's wrong, and I think it scares some people away.
Walk with us. Where are we going?
Down a lot better path than I was before.
Walk with us.
And I can tell you it ain't into the front of a new bar or anything like that.
So you are all smiles and successful now, which I'm really happy to see. But why don't you take us back to that time by the Apple Store? Because it's funny as hell.
Well, I'm glad you can laugh now. I can barely start laughing about it.
It didn't happen to me.
A lot of people do. And look, I realize if that story helps people come forward, and if we can laugh a little bit about it and also be serious about it, then look, at, you know, maybe it's time for me to tell that story. It's been told by everybody else but me. But, you know, it's no secret that my ex-wife had written a book about our marriage and how she escaped an emotionally abusive relationship. And while I was working in Milwaukee as an investigative reporter, I saw that I got a copy of the book in February, about 5 months before it was released, and the wheels on the wagon came off. I had to deal with a lot of things I hadn't thought about in 10, 12 years since we've been divorced, and there was media attention, there was people, you know, really picking on you, so all this built up over time. And what happened one night, it was an interview with Dr. Drew. She was on there, they were talking about my alcoholism, they were talking about, and it just got under my skin. And they never had my side of the story on there or anything, so I ran out of booze at home. And in Milwaukee, they stopped serving at 9 o'clock, or stopped selling, so I couldn't go down to Trader Joe's and get it. But I saw out of the corner of my eye a bar in the corner, and I'm like, perfect, a couple more shots, all I have to do is walk, perfect. The alcoholic mind thinking, perfect, then I'll be able to go to sleep. Well, I went, I had a couple Jägerbomb shots, had a couple glasses of wine, I was, you know, pretty much where I wanted to get, and then I had about 100 feet walk home, and I stopped. And for some unknown reason, and that's just welcome to the drunk world, I decided to, you know, take a leak next to the Apple Store, you know, down there. A security guard for the mall caught me there, and he wanted to ban me, but I lived there, so he had to come up with something else. The Apple people were trying to let him go, you know, do whatever, and he called the Glendale Police Department, and as a drunk, you know, at that stage I was getting into Zoom Zoom land, it was just bad. So when they came, I mouthed off to them a little bit, so I got the bonus plan opposed to just a ticket. So, you know, they booked me, they took my photo, and then, you know, the rest, a couple weeks later, it made the news, and, you know, everything came tumbling down. Now I was associated with, you know, the ex-wife's book and everything else, and, you know, people saw, what they saw in that video and what they heard about was a guy who was at the end of his rope. I mean, that's what booze will do to you. Mine was caught in every angle. From the street of in front of Bayshore Mall in Glendale, right to the police intake. That was all results of alcoholism.
Well, now I'm going to get a bunch of hate emails because I was laughing. And the way you told me over the phone, it was funny. Now it's like, I'm sorry.
No. I think we got to, part of me when I went to rehab, and, you know, they told me, you know, the counselors and everything, said, you know, Rob, you have an amazing story to tell, and that, you know, someday that it will help so many others. And I'm like, yeah, really? How the hell is that going to help anybody? I took a leak on the Apple store. I was mad. You know, I'm like, you guys think this is a great story? Look, I've learned if it brings attention to alcoholism and people understand what it was and the things, you know, that happened that night, then okay. You know, I'm blessed in the sense that, look, I wasn't behind the wheel of a car. I didn't kill myself. I didn't kill anybody else. It was the most embarrassing and humbling moment of my life, all caught, you know, but it's also a good reminder of why I don't drink. You know, and I feel more for my family because of the what they see, and that's difficult. But, you know, we've all come a long way. We understand the disease better, and I was fairly able to, you know, pick up some pieces, and, you know, thanks to Google, it's just hard to, you know, move forward with that, and I think there's a huge stigma attached to addiction. So, you know, that's what I hope the documentary does. I hope people come forward with their stories. Mine's sort of strange, unique, but there's other great stories out there of those people that are now, you know, sober.
Yes. Okay. That was a great setup. So tell us about your movie, and your poster is amazing. I have to tell you that that's quite a hottie picture of someone who's drunk. It's probably the hottest picture I've seen of someone who's drunk just got their butt kicked.
Well, thanks. No, I'm blushing. I got a couple good blows in that night. You know, that is actually a picture from the Phoenix Police Department. I did not provoke this, which I really wasn't a guy that provoked fights, but I was with a friend, and she was dropping me off at home. A couple guys dragged me out of the car, and that was a result of fighting, and Phoenix PD came out there to take some pictures and try to find the perpetrators of that. They were never found. But the documentary, to me, obviously, is very close to my heart. The filmmaker, Quincy Gardner, is an amazing director. He's a young guy. He's up and coming, and he's passionate about it, too. And what we want to do is, you know, share our experiences, you know, with other people. You know, yes, you'll hear more about mine. You'll take a walk, you know, in the shoes that I did, you know, during active addiction, winning Emmy Awards, you know, interviewing presidents and vice presidents, all the things you do. And you'll also see, you know, another side of a marriage that, you know, I was struggling with, you know, as well. Another, you know, Christi, my ex-wife, we were both in the business. We met as co-anchors. So you're going to see, you know, a love story that also developed, you know, along with that side of addiction. And then what we really want to do is we want to include some other people's stories in there too, with the goal of, hey, my name is Rob. Yes, I may be an alcoholic, but look at all these great things that I've done now and where we're at and what I've overcome. And there's nothing to be ashamed about on that. And I want people that are, you know, comfortable with that to do it. You know, I, for lack of a better term, let's get up in their face and tell them, you know, hey, enough. We're so educated now, and we're, you know, with tolerance and education, you know, we hear these terms of drunk, pill popper. It's wrong. That is wrong, because that's as, you know, as much of a derogatory term as some other ones that, you know, guys are in the news for today.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm really on board with identifying a person as a human being first, and then seeing what else is there. And sometimes it's good, and sometimes it's not. It's called being person first.
Shira, you're right. We're human. And I think, you know, I don't care if you're a TV news reporter, if you're a professional athlete, or you're the CEO of a company. We're human. We have flaws. And for people to, you know, put it up like that and not expect it, hell, if they live in a perfect world, invite me to it, because I'd like to see that utopia and how it is. Because mine's not, but I've learned from things.
And that's all we can do. Okay, let's segue into your trailer so everyone can see.
Okay. Well, I mean, you know, basically what you're going to be seeing at is a sneak peek of the journey, as you like, or, you know, a little bit of look of what we're trying to do.
All right, let's take a look. This is Rob in Shattered. Wow, Rob, that was really on point.
Great, I'm glad. You know, again, I hope that message gets out to people and that they'll come forward and, you know, we're getting to the post-production period where we still need a couple of other people's stories. So, you know, you've got my contact information. I'd love to hear theirs as well, and we may, you know, be able to include them in part of that film, because I think it's so important to see everybody's reaction, not just the TV news guys, not just celebrities who have it. We're all in this together.
So what's the buzz? Have you been in contact with any of your former colleagues?
Yeah, I mean, I let family and friends see it before. I think, a huge support, but that's family and friends. I've gotten some emails that, you know, say also, you know, look at this drunk idiot, you know, all that kind of stuff. I expect it. You know, now I'm healthier to be able to handle with that, but that's the stigma that, you know, I'm trying to fight. So come on, guys, you know, you want to put that stuff down there, it doesn't help anybody. But I think it's been a good reaction. I think that as the film, you know, as people start learning more and more about the film, it'll definitely draw some reaction.
You know, I'm glad that you said that. It surprises me when people are not as embracing as the support that I've received. And I really think it's so damaging for someone who's trying to change to get such a negative response. And a lot of people are so habituated, they kind of use that as an anchor to weigh them down. It's like, well, if this is the reaction I'm going to get,
exactly.
Then what's
exactly.
The point? Yeah.
Well, that's exactly it. Why would we come forward and say we're struggling this and put our hand out for help when that's the way we treat people? Why would you? And I mean, it kept me for years and years with, you know, Christi and I both being on TV. One of our marriage counselors told me, well, the best idea is, you know, stop drinking. Well, I'm an alcoholic. I mean, I just can't turn that off, man. I mean, and, you know, so I beat myself up, and I definitely didn't want the stigma attached because I was worried about, you know, losing a job because of that. Of course, that would have been better had I gotten help than what happened in front of the Apple store, but, you know, it is what it is.
Why did you lose your job?
I ended up resigning, so I lost my job, and, you know, if you're an investigative reporter and you're holding the powerful accountable, they'll look for things, you know, it's fair game. So they were building up a lot of stuff. They had Christie's book that had come out, so they wanted to talk about it, which, you know, some of the things in her book are correct, other things are made up lies. I mean, it's a tough situation to deal with. I think, you know, it's unfortunate, you know, and I guess you're hitting on the right thing, is why didn't the station, you know, offer the hand for help? I don't know. I mean, they knew I was struggling. I think TV news is a very unforgiving business. I think that you put people on a pedestal and they forget that, you know, we're all, like we said earlier, are human. We have our flaws. None of those flaws prevented me from doing my job. I was winning Emmys. I was winning Edward R. Murrow Awards. All those things. Does that, because I'm an alcoholic and I had that struggle, does that make me now unemployable in TV news? Apparently.
Well, how do you think they would cover a story like yours if they're not able to extend themselves to someone who works for them, who's part of their broadcast family?
I think that, you know, it's a double-edged sword. You know, lots of things happens in newsrooms. You get me in trouble with the news people, but lots of things happen in newsrooms that never go reported that we report on in companies, you know, in this day every day. When it comes down to minimum wage, when it comes to the Standard Labor Act law, there's violations left and right in your newsroom. Are we reporting those? No. Do we report them against other companies? Oh, yeah, they're all fair game, but don't look into our own fishbowl. And that's wrong. And, you know, it's perceived in news, at least with the managers that I've had, that you're an alcoholic, you have that. Yeah, bye-bye.
Well, now I think a lot of us are familiar with Susan Varga. She's some reporter, I think, for 2020. And
yep.
She came out as an alcoholic. She went to treatment. She's back on the air. So do you think things have changed since your ordeal?
Yeah, I think it all depends on the management. Elizabeth Vargas came out of Phoenix. She's made her struggle.
Yeah,
it's okay. No, you're right. Elizabeth Vargas, has had her struggle and everything. She came forward, is the story that I've read. She came forward to ABC and said, "Hey, look, I've got this problem. I think I could have, if I had done that, it was past the fact after what had happened at the Apple Store." But again, it's a double-edged sword. I worried about that. But, for Elizabeth Vargas, ABC seems to be giving her a huge amount of support. And, I can only wish her the best, going forward, that she's able to get that too and just move on. She's very talented. She's been through a lot in her life.
Well, I really hope that's going to be more fruitful for people that are in broadcasting or in any business where they need help. And I thought that was the law, where if an employer saw that you were having some issues, that they were to make treatment available. So that's,
I think it is. I think it's also, like, since we work on contracts, so you'll probably last your next contract. Do they hire you again? I don't know. I would like to see that, there's plenty of trade magazines that out there that are more like police blotters when, people get in trouble in TV news. That's the only thing that they post out there. These people are human, too, just like doctors, just like lawyers. Now, does it make it, possible for me to drive a bus because of, something like that? Maybe not. or be a cop or something. Sure, I've limited myself because of my past curricular activities, as a alcoholic. But for the stigma to just stick there and not let people try to move forward, I've done my stuff. I've taken responsibility for the problems I had in my marriage, for the things that, I unfortunately said to Christi, and I regret that. I regret so much. Both of us didn't understand alcoholism. Both of us didn't understand, as Dr. Drew put it in that trailer, no AA, no Al-Anon, it's not going to get better. And, for some reason we didn't go down that path, and that's a long time ago, but, we regret these things, and I have to, clean up my past, along the way. But once people do, Shira, I think that, why are we still lumping them back to that day and putting the stigma attached to them? Look at what I've accomplished, since then.
I think we have to just change our perspective on this. It's like, look what I've done. Look what I've accomplished now despite my history. It's look what I've done because of my history.
Yes. Yeah, I think it's a great idea. And, I don't mind showing them the mess before. Let's take a look at where I'm at now. In 2 years, I'm battling, to grab job, whatever I can. I've got a roof over my head. I've got a family that supports me. I'm such a lucky man and very grateful for all those things. But I will go out there and I'll battle the, what's attached to the stigma. And I'll start looking people in the eye and say, why not give me that second chance? I'm qualified. Look at what I've done. Look at how far I've come. Look what I did in active addiction. What? Come on, man. You're getting a good deal on somebody who's now sober, clean, and ready to work. We're the hardest working people out there and caring people when we're not drinking or using.
Yeah, I really agree with that. I think we've really put ourselves through the ringer, and we're so grateful that we were able to claw our way out of it. So
Yeah. Somebody said, one of my friends said, we're actually people that, and addicts and alcoholics, we've actually been to hell and we've made it back. And I think that's really powerful what he said, and I'll steal it from him, because I think we have seen hell. I think that we've sat there for a few minutes or maybe longer, but we were able to make it out, and that's one of the hardest things to do.
And it really needs to be said that stories like yours, and I laugh, but I laugh because I have plenty of my own freaking stories, trust me.
Stupid things we've done, we should laugh, I laugh now more too, imagine, at the time, it's just, you're going, oh my God, or I do a Skype interview with, somebody at TV station, they ask what happened, and I'm like, well, the Apple Store, then I'm just looking for the off button. I'm like, this is just sounds awful. There's no way I'm going to get this job. And they can Google, So, I think we have to laugh somewhat at it. If I bring people, together by laughing and doing that, and then we talk, about how they can change their lives, fine. I'm okay with it now. I haven't been to an Apple Store, though, in 2 years. I will admit, I have an Apple iPhone. I update it. I go to the AT&T store when I need to buy a new one. I'll have to make amends with them somewhere down the line.
Oh, that's so funny. We're giving Apple so much play.
We are, and I don't mean to. I had some.
We're not
I had
sponsoring
people,
this show, okay? So stop mentioning them.
Between, you know what a great addict show between Starbucks and Apple. I think I've hit all of them today. And, now, that was a big mall. I mean, how I picked that, I think it was like the lights were still on. They were getting ready for the release, the iPhone 4 or something. God only knows. You know, sorry, Apple.
Yeah. Well, you know, it does happen, and I think that's the whole point. I mean, we, so many of us have so many missteps on our way to sobriety, and we have to find our own way in our own time and whatever that means. And I've done plenty of things I regret, and at the time I was so ashamed and I was so guilt-ridden and it just tore me up inside, and I just had to learn to really let it go, to process it. That's not who I am now. It's not how I identify myself. It was a time that I worked through, and now I'm here today. So I can laugh at my own crap, and that's what it is, you know. And the only thing, and like I told you before, is do I have regrets? I have a few. Let's break out into song. So
yeah, I love that song. But you did it your way.
I did it my way.
We always do. As alcoholics and addicts, we always tend to do it our way to the very end, which gets us that seat in rehab, or you know what I mean.
America. Yeah, I was trying to get on America's Funniest Videos, but I got mugshots.
Yeah, you know, I think that we're very different of what we have in our memory books.
Yeah, I didn't really think that one through.
But you were right. You know, you talked about that shame that keeps you using or drinking, and to me, that's the most powerful one that's out there, and that's so can be deadly. Because I've had two of my friends that I went through extended treatment with died OD'd a week apart, and it was shame, and it was shame that got those guys, and such a powerful feeling emotion.
And there's so many, there's millions of people that are suffering from this. So I really am having always a hard time trying to understand why is there so much stigma attached to it. And having these conversations and being so open, it does nothing but good. And when I tell people, because I always say I wear my recovery on my sleeve, and I literally want to get a T-shirt that has recovery on the sleeve.
I thought about the other things. I've seen some groups come out, got recovery hats, and I think, or it's a T-shirt that says, ask me about my recovery. People go, oh, my God. But, hey, why not?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
We're proud of it. You know, let's get the dialogue, you know, started there. But I agree with you. That shame is what keeps them, you know, with that stigma, and, you know, they see how it's treated in society, and I think that's wrong.
It is wrong. And, you know, what I was going to say is when I wear a recovery oriented shirt, someone will ask me, what does that mean, down with stigma? And it's always just an invitation for a dialogue. And it never fails. There's always, it's different stages, but they're always the same. First they're embarrassed, and then they're awkward. And then they always tell me somebody that they know, their brother, their son, their daughter, their grandmother.
Yes. So
I have never had a conversation with someone who said, I've never been affected by someone's addiction.
That's right. That's right. Now, you're right. You nailed all those stages. You know, it's that look. They don't know what to say. And then it's like, oh, so it's beautiful out. But, of course, you got a monsoon coming. And then, you know, then they sort of, then they feel like, well, if this person's coming, I'm going to share a little bit. I get, you know, so many people sharing about that. You're right.
Yeah. So, and it's, you know, it used to be awkward for me, too. And people always are so impressed with me that how can you be so open, and that's so fantastic, and it's so great. And I was like, you know, it wasn't always that way. I was awkward and a little ashamed, and I didn't really know what to say, but it's something I had to do, and just like you, Google really helped me push past that shame and guilt and fear, because it's on the internet. I mean, there's no way I can run from this. So I went through that, you know, damn Google you know what? Google, it really helped push my process right along. And now I'm doing a show on Google. Thanks, Google.
Yeah, no, you've done, that's a good point. I didn't even think about that. You're using Google to a tool, and I think, you know, you do have to reevaluate where you are. Not everybody may feel comfortable, but, you know, since I was sort of outed, you know, A, by my own actions, and B, you know, by my ex-wife, Christy, doing that stuff, you're right. Okay, but you have to get, like you said, it took a while to get used to, you know, being like that, you know, and approaching people about it.
Yeah, but it's really empowering, and I realize, and I say this to a lot of people, I'm in a fantastic position. I've positioned myself where I can be this open, and I can be this vocal, and I have people coming to me all the time and just talking, and that's how change starts. You have to see what resources are available and who's being inspiring or who's crazy enough just to be like, you know, like me, where this is it, people. You know, you've seen me at my best, you've seen me at my worst, and now you see me today. And through the whole process, this is who I've become. And so it really is an eye-opener for a lot of people that would never be able to, you know, because they could have a job where they could lose it, or they have their pillars in the community and their reputations would be devastated. So for those of us that do have the option to be this open, I really hope that it resonates with those that would like to be. But at least if it just helps them to say, you know, I don't have to be as shame-based as I thought I was. Look at these people.
Yep. I mean, it all helps in the long run. You know, however you feel important, you know, to stand up to it, but I think that it helps to dialogue. Some people feel comfortable doing what you and I are doing. Other people won't. But if we can help them that way, that's fine. It's all about helping, sharing this message and trying to educate those that don't understand. Because as you said, you know, I don't care if you're the alcoholic or the addict or you're the son or daughter, you know, of one. It's impacted your life one way or another, or of a friend.
Absolutely. It's the butterfly effect, and I really see changes. So when I hear people who are trying to be open and trying to share themselves and grow, and then to hear such negative feedback, they're being attacked for this, it's really unsettling. But it just motivates me to you know, set the discourse aside and to continue to talk and create those dialogues. I mean, we are catalysts for change, and that's such an important role. But, you know, with the count, we have to have our own accountability, and I think that helps me in my sobriety. I was talking with someone, and they were trying to reconcile that they want to be sober, but then they still want to go, you know, and hang out with their friends and do all this bar scene, and I just said, do you think you would ever find me in a bar? And right away, he was like, no. And I said, you know, because it's a lifestyle. And these are choices. These are choices I make every day. I choose not to drink. I choose not to go into situations where it might be hard for me. And I choose to have this show and to provide resources. And, you know, everything I do is with conviction, and it's by choice. So... Mm-hmm. And this is why I'm able to do what I do, because I make healthier choices now than I used to.
Isn't it a much better feeling, you know, to make those choices and have that focus and guidance, you know, to do that? It takes off all that extra added pressure of hiding the use and all those things that we did before.
It's amazing. It's so much easier to be sober than my... Like, you talk about winning Emmys and the Murrow Award. I mean, if I could have won Victim of the Year, I would have rocked that. You know, get a Victim of the Year tiara in the banner. You know, thank all the bars that kicked me out and all the cops that arrested me to get me where I am today, you know. And that life sucked. It was awful. It was exhausting, and I am grateful, and I feel like it was a humbling experience, and I went from I don't have this and I don't have that to I'm grateful for everything. I'm grateful that I have a phone, that I, you know, like, I don't have to be ashamed walking around because I know what I did last night. I know where my phone is, you know.
Yep. You don't have to look at the text and see who you text, you know, and you know, all those things. It takes a huge weight off your shoulders, but it takes a little time to get there.
And it takes a lot of work.
Mm-hmm. Well, people don't, you know, I think that's one of the greatest things. They don't realize how much work it was. You know, the first time around, I think I was like, okay, stop drinking, everything will be fine. Oh, no, that's just the start. Now I get it. Now I get it.
Yeah, but I think, you know, if we apply that work ethic to be drunk.
That's true.
That was a hard life. That was, you know, I worked very hard. I was very diligent in that lifestyle. So, and I hear that a lot from people. It's like, work this hard for your own happiness. And I really feel like if you can make it to the other side and you can do the work and you have the initiative, sometimes you won't have those people there to motivate and support you. But this is really for you. So yeah. you have to keep pushing on because it's for you. And then you can rebuild.
Yep. No, and I think, and then that's the most important thing. It's for you. I read Rob Lowe's book, the first one. I think it was great. You know, he, you know, realized that, you know, I can't go for my kids. I can't go for my wife. I had to go for myself. And that's really what it is all about. If we're going to try to save something, it may already be gone by the time, you know, we're starting to get help. And it really is. And then I think the rest, you know, falls into place. Look, it's not a pink cloud all the time. It's a lot of work, just like life is. But that's life, and we're dealing with it now. What do they say? I mean, the good news is when we stop using is we're going to get our feelings back. The bad news is we're going to get our feelings back.
Yeah.
You know, and it's true. Now I just know how I have to cope with them without booze.
Absolutely, and it's possible. I mean, recovery is possible, and that is our message of the day. So tell us a little bit more about, before we wrap it up, about your movie and what's going on. Are you doing final touches? Where can we see this movie? What's going on?
Awesome questions. I love that. Yes, we are doing final touches. As I said, too, we're looking for a couple of other people's stories that we can feature in there, too, that are comfortable, you know, telling them on camera with us. Mm-hmm. We're reaching out to a couple of people that, you know, I worked out with in my past. I say, you know, I can't guarantee it yet, but Mike Tyson is somebody I've done a lot of stories with who is no stranger to addiction and struggling. I'd love to get back in touch and maybe we'll sit down and talk about the days, you know, when we both did that. And the main key then probably too is, you know, wrap up the movie and hit it to film festivals. What we're hoping is, you know, taking it out to the film festivals will also help spread that message. You brought up Real Recovery, which is a great film festival that I would love. Hopefully, you know, it'll be a good enough finished product that they'll show it, you know, in one of their cities. So, we're targeting that. We'll see. We may have to go to Kickstarter to just finish up the last few pre-production, licensing, lawyers, all those great things, because there are some people that aren't necessarily happy about some of the stories being told, but, you know, hey, it comes with the territory. Again, the message is we're going to break that stigma, and we're going to do it any which way we can. And I'm sort of an Old Testament guy, so I'm ready to, you know, take on those battles as we do it. But I think that even the people that may be hesitant see this message and say, hey, how can I be against something like that? And that's really what it comes down to. I mean, you know, we're going to beat up people that are in recovery or people that are struggling out there? No. They need that hand because those people all learned, you know, you folks all learned along with my family too. You guys loved me until I could love myself. And, you know, we got to do that for more people. We got to make it a safe environment, you know, for them to come forward and do that and have the patience.
Wow, Rob, you're gonna choke me up a little bit.
About time. That was... Hey, you're a tough nut to crack too, Shira. I'm passionate. You've lost friends. I've lost friends. Alcoholism, addiction has ravaged both sides of my family. Enough of this. Recovery can run through a family just like addiction. So let's do that.
Wow, on that note, I just kind of summed it up better myself, but I haven't won any Emmys, so.
Hey, you're young. Life is still young. You got the show. I mean, it's all about that. I'll send you a link to where you can submit.
All right. Well, for anyone who's interested in possibly sharing their story with Rob and his movie Shattered, if you would like any more additional information, we'll be sure to put that up. Thank you so much, Rob. You're just such a charming man.
Well, I'm glad I can be that now. I appreciate you. And, you know, you're doing a great cause. Thank you for what you're doing. You've been doing it, and I know you're very passionate about it. So having me on, I'm so glad to be able to do this work together with you.
Thanks. All right, let's catch Rob's movie. We'll keep you updated underneath the comments. If you would like to contact him directly, just find the show and submit your email, and if he can, he'll get back to you. So, thanks, Rob.
See you, Shira.
Bye.